7, verses 12 to 16. And in this, it talks about the blessings of obedience. And it says, "Then it shall come to pass, because you listen to these judgments, and keep and do them, that the Lord your God will keep with you the covenant and the mercy which he swore to your fathers. And he will love you and bless you and multiply you. He will also bless the fruit of your womb and the fruit of your land, your grain and your new wine and your oil, the increase of your cattle and the offspring of your flock, in the land of which he swore to your fathers to give you. You shall be blessed above all peoples. There shall not be a male or female barren among you or among your livestock. And the Lord will take away from you all the sickness and will afflict you with none of the terrible diseases of Egypt, which you have known, and will lay them on you, all those who hate you. Also, you shall destroy all the people whom the Lord your God delivers over to you. Your eyes shall have no pity on them, nor shall you serve their gods, for that will be a snare to you."
Thank you, Zach. Man, where did that deep voice come from? Used to be a little kid just not long ago. It's good to be back. We've been traveling for a little bit, and so Nancy and I are glad to be home. I'm especially glad she's home. That's always a good thing. We have a lot of people who are up at camp today, and so I know it may look a little bit emptier today because we have a bunch of people up there. My thanks to Joel for preaching last week, and so I'm just glad to be back, and it was a great time to be able to see grandkids and everything else. So that was always a good thing. So I want to talk to you today about increase. I don't know if you're ready for an increase in something, increase in salary, increase in your sleep time, in your rest time, in your happy time, and not in your work time, right? But a lot of times that's what we're looking for, is for an increase. What can we get that's bigger, something that's better? One of the things that came out a long time ago is the idea that there is all you can eat, right? And you'd always go to those places where it's all you can eat. I mean, you can just eat yourself sick. And you can just go back plate after plate after plate. And, you know, back in the past, that was a good thing because you could eat a lot. Now, I think that I lose money because all I can eat is the one plate that you would bring me anyway. So that's not such a good deal anymore. But for some reason, we thought this was a great thing. All you can eat. You can just eat and eat forever. You could be stuffed, and you get that great stuffed feeling, which is, you know, right before you're sick. And, you know, it's just this wonderful feeling. I couldn't hold another bite. It's something that's so good. And that's what we think is good. And so when you drive through to get a Happy Meal, it's, well, let's supersize it, right? At least the fries are big and the drink is, they're not going to give you a bigger sandwich. But, you know, let's supersize whatever meal we order. So we want to do more and have more and get more. And a lot of our advertising is aimed at that type of thing. Let's do more. Let's have more. We want to make more money than what we made last year. We want to have more time off than what we had last year. We want to enjoy things more than what we did last year. We want newer and bigger and better. And I think that's one of the things that people want about God. I want a God that's going to give me more. And I think that was originally the reason why people worshiped God in the very beginning. Because if I can pray to this God, he will send rain, and then my crops will grow, and then I will have more. And so a lot of the concept of worshiping God came out of this idea that God gives me more. And so it's not really surprising today that you get a lot of the health, wealth, gospel, God will make you well, God will make you wealthy, and everything you could ever want is because, you know, God will do this for you. And so it became one of those things that, you know, God's going to give the increase all the time until sometimes people could see through all of that. The increase of things is not always from God. And so when we start looking at it and we start looking at this passage that we have that is from Deuteronomy, it's right as the people are about to go into the land of Canaan, and he does promise more. He says, I'm going to give you more, and this is a way of blessing. And he talks about everything that you do is going to be good. It's this promise to Israel that he would bless them, and if they would listen, and if they would keep the rules, keep the covenant that he is making with them, I'll love you, I'll bless you, I'll multiply you. I'll multiply everything that you've got. Everything that is in your house, all of the flocks, all of the herds, everything that's there. I won't multiply disease, I'll put disease on your enemy, and you won't be sick ever again. How great a health insurance is that? That's the kind I wish we had. You'll never be sick again. And it's this outpouring of love on them and saying, you know, the way I'm going to express this love that I have for you is to give you more. And so that you're going to see that you're blessed among all the people and that you have more than what anybody else has. It's God's way of making a relationship, is giving this abundance. And so it's in giving gifts. And not only that, but it's success in everything that they own, everything that they have, everything that they do. All the crops are going to produce more. And so he says, this is the way in which it's going to be a blessing, that God is truly blessing you, because they are God's chosen people. He says, you're special above all others. You're the ones I have chosen to bring into this new land. And so as they're looking at this new land, certainly they have the favor of God. They're about to go into this new place, and they're going to have more flocks, more herds, more of everything. You would think the people would respond to that and would say, that's great. I'm going to be more obedient. I'm going to worship more. I'm going to pray more. I'm going to reverence my God more. I'm going to really be dedicated more to following him. And that isn't the way it worked. I said, good, we got more stuff. We got more flocks, we got more herds, we got more crops. We're pretty rich. We could go pay for a good God. And they fell away. Because they didn't quite understand the way in which it all works. So how do we read this? How did they get more? And we might think it's because of their obedience. But essentially it's because they were children of Abraham. And Abraham was a man of faith, so the way in which they got more was because of the faith relationship that Abraham had with God. And them being his descendants put them into that situation, and then if they have obedience and they keep that relationship, they got it by the faith of Abraham. They keep it by the obedience to the covenant. And faith is different than obedience. We'll deal more with that later sometime. But that's what he's trying to get across. You have this special place. You have this special covenant because of the faith of Abraham. We think wealth, but I think it was more than that. Was God just trying to make them rich? I don't think God had any idea of making them rich so that they wouldn't need him anymore. He was making them blessed. You see, back in that time, you didn't always have the store where you could go to find bread. And so just having bread meant life. And there's sometimes where the comparison is that way. If you've got bread, that means you get to live. If you don't have bread, then that means you have to grow some wheat in order to grind some flour, in order to mix it with some... It's going to take a long time. So if you don't have bread, you're probably not going to live. And what he's doing here is, I'm giving you this safety, I'm giving you this security, I'm giving you life, this huge life, this abundant life, where you're not going to have to worry about this. You're not going to have to worry about death. And God's promising more than wealth. Wealth comes out of it. But he's promising more than wealth. It's an increase in every area. In the children that they have, in the crops that they have, in the animals that they have, in the safety that they have. Back then, 100 sheep meant great things. It meant you were going to eat for a long time. Today, if you've got 100 sheep in your backyard, it means city violations. It's not necessarily a good thing. And so that would not be much of a blessing from God. But they misunderstood the blessing of more. This has to do with the idea of a hundredfold. And there are several times in the Bible where he mentions this phrase, the hundredfold, that there will be an increase of a hundredfold. If you look at Matthew chapter 13, the parable of the sower talks about this idea of a hundredfold. And I'm just going to summarize the parable and then look at the explanation this morning so that we've got a little bit more time with it. He talks about a sower, and it is a kingdom parable, so he's talking about his kingdom. The sower went out and sowed. Some seed fell on the road, and birds came and ate it. Some seed fell on rocky ground, and it sprung up, and then there were too many rocks and didn't have deep soil, and so the sun scorched it, and it died. And then some seed fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up, and the thorns basically choked it out. And then some seed fell on the good soil, and the good soil produced hundredfold. Some 60, some 30, some a hundredfold. Well, that's a great thing. That's a great blessing. And Jesus is bringing that parable across and saying, this is what God is like now. We do have a God of more. And God does want to bless. And God does want to give. But I think we have to understand how it all works. And so we can get this mixed up a little bit. We think the explanation of this whole thing is the road is the people who didn't hear. The rocks are maybe the people who have too many hard things going on in their life. The thorns are, well, there's some bad influences in our life. And the good soil is where God makes big churches. God gives people a whole lot more, and he makes them rich, and he makes them wealthy, and he makes churches big, and everybody's blessed. And that is absolutely the wrong explanation of that parable. I know because Jesus gives us the explanation of the parable. And so that makes it a lot easier for us to be able to see what it's really about. So when you look in verse 18, it's here the parable of the sower. And then he begins to give you what his explanation truly is. When anyone hears the words of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. This is what was sown along the path. And for what was sown on the rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy, but he has no root in himself, but endures for a while, and then when tribulation and persecution arise on account of the word, immediately he falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. As for what was sown on the good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it. He indeed bears fruit and yields in one case a hundredfold, in another 60, in another 30. And so the real explanation, he talks about the road as being the people with the bad influence. And they didn't quite understand it. They didn't get it. And so Satan comes along or sends people along and they take it away. And so it's more that kind of idea. They didn't get it. It's in one ear, out the other. And then they're distracted by all these other people. And so it goes on. The rocks he talks about are hard things. And we're not immune to that. Some people can have such a difficult life. It's really hard to hear anything good. It's hard for them to even grasp what you're talking about because their life is so hard and so difficult. as they deal with people who are always critical of them, and they deal with situations that are always difficult. And maybe there's medical situations, or maybe it's people in their life that are difficult and cruel. But it can be really hard to listen to what is good. And so they just can't hang on. There's no depth of soil, and it says they fall away. And so they're not able to maintain that. They don't have a root in themselves. They don't hold on to anything. They aren't permanent type of people. They just go from one thing to the next. And when it gets too difficult, they just decide, oh, well, we'll go on to the next. And then the thorns is the one I wanted to emphasize today. They hear and they grow the same as the person with the rocks. But then it says the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches choke them out. I got an actual picture from my backyard. This is grass trying to grow, and thorns are, very difficult. But he says what the thorns are is not the bad influences in your life. What the thorns are is the good things that you have. Thorns are the wealth. Okay, wait a minute. That doesn't make sense. Because it seems like God was giving them all of these good things and all of this wealth, and then, they fell away, right? Yeah. Because all of that wealth becomes the... So then why would God be a God of more? And Jesus tells this parable saying, God's not going to give you any more. That's wrong. Because there still is the good soil to come. And the good soil yields 100-fold. But the thorns are the wealth that you have. And so the 100-fold is not wealth. The 100-fold is blessing of God. And it's maybe more of an intangible thing than what I know how to exactly explain, but it's not the fact that you got richer. It's not the fact that you have more stuff, because that tends to take us away from God. And Jesus is giving this parable to say, sometimes you've got all these riches in your life, and God is not going to take those away. God is, you just got to realize those can be bad for you. And that those are not something that may be in the blessing of God. So why would God give you more things that's going to make you go away from Him? Well, He's going to give you more. You know that from the good soil. Some bears 100-fold because it bears fruit. And so the fruit is not just wealth. Fruitfulness and growth are different. We think growth is the most important thing, and we apply growth to everything. I want growth in my salary. I want growth in my church. I want growth in my family. I want growth in, everything's supposed to grow and get bigger and better. And God's saying, wait a minute. Let me give you an increase, but be careful about how it comes. Having too much is difficult for us. You may feel like, I want to win the lottery. I could handle that, $10 million. Say it got to $10 million. I would know exactly where I would do with it. I'm not sure it always turns out as a blessing to most of the people who win lotteries. And we may feel like we could handle it, but I don't think it always works out that way. Sometimes having too much increases the hard things around. In Ecclesiastes chapter 5, there was a guy who won every lottery there ever was. He was the richest man in the world. He's king of Israel. And he said this in Ecclesiastes 5:10. He who loves money will not be satisfied with money, nor he who loves wealth with his income. This also is vanity. When goods increase, they increase who eat them. What advantage has the owner but to see them with his eyes? Sweet is the sleep of a laborer, whether he eats little or much. But the full stomach of the rich man will not let him sleep. loves money doesn't get to be satisfied by money, even if he got the money. And Jesus is constantly warning about the rich man. Wealth may come, but it's not always a blessing from God. Sometimes it is very difficult to deal with. It puts you into a whole different situation, a whole different category of temptations. And I like the way he puts it here is when, you know, wealth increases, so do the number of people who want it. And suddenly you have a whole lot more friends, and they're going to come and help you spend it. And you see that happening sometimes. But the person, it's not that God doesn't give wealth, because to some people he does. And they do a great job with it. But to some people it can become a curse. Now we do have a God of increase. I want you to be aware of that. We do have a God of increase. It's how he made the world. He made the world to be able to grow. He made plants so that when that one pine cone finally plants and produces a pine tree, there's a whole lot more pine cones and trees. When that one grain of wheat falls into the earth and produces a stalk of wheat, there's a whole lot more than just one grain of wheat. And so the way in which God set up the world is this idea of abundance, this idea of more, that it does grow and flourish and replenish and in everything. And it's the way that God is. It's his personality. And God's blessings always mean more. But I think we have to be careful about the way in which the more comes. In Matthew chapter 19, in verse 23, he talks to his disciples because they are confused about this same question. He's just talked to a rich young ruler, and the rich young ruler has come and said, I've kept all the commandments, what else do I have to do? And he says, well, I want you to sell everything, give it to the poor, and then come follow me. And he goes away and is sad because he's not willing to do that. He does want to follow God. And maybe the wealth of God would replace the wealth he already has, but he's already rich. So why would he give away the riches in order to get riches? It doesn't make sense. I could be blessed by God. And when you start thinking about it, the rich young ruler isn't able to handle this because he already has the more. He doesn't need the more. He's already got the more. And he wouldn't trade his more for God's more. And the story unfolds this way as the disciples begin to ask about, well, then, you know, how is this even possible? Because rich men do good things and, you know, they're the ones who would be saved. And so Jesus says in verse 23 of Matthew 19, Jesus said to his disciples, truly I say to you, only with difficulty will a rich person enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I tell you, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. But when the disciples heard this, they were greatly astonished, saying, then who can be saved? And Jesus looked at them and said, with man it is impossible, with God all things are possible. And Peter said in reply, see, we have left everything and followed you. What then will we have? Whole question of more, right? What do I get out of this? And Jesus said to them, truly I say to you, in the new world, when the Son of Man will sit on his glorious throne, you who have followed me will sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or fathers or mother or children or lands for my name's sake will receive 100-fold and will inherit eternal life. But many who are first will be last, last first. And so as he talks here about this idea of this hundredfold and about the blessings that they're going to receive, Jesus does not deny the fact that God is a God of more, and that God gives more, and that God gives wealth, and he gives riches as he tries to bless with the more. But understand also that just wealth is not always good. And so he may not give you wealth because he knows better what you're able to handle. And it might be too big a temptation for you to misuse it on yourself rather than using it for other people, which is the reason he gave it to you. And when we try to understand what this is all about and put all this together, because the disciples are very confused about this, and we can become too. They're saying, well, I don't even understand who can be saved because they seem to do so many good things, and what do we get out of this? And he talks about not more wealth, but about more of what they gave up. He says, you're going to have houses and sisters and brothers and fathers and mothers, and when you left that for my name's sake, the hundredfold and eternal life. And as you watch that work out, you don't read of rich apostles. It isn't that they became wealthy. In fact, they used what they had and usually spent it all. But they did have more God. They did have more grace. They did have more faith. And the fruit of their work you can see in a powerful way. And the church grew. But I'm not sure it's the numbers that was the growth that we need to look at. It was the way in which that church functioned. The relationship that they had. And the more comes out in relationships more than anything else. It's deeper relationships. Not that they knew more people, but it's deeper relationships. And it would take more time and it would take more intensity for them in these relationships. But there's more happiness. There's more joy. There's more salvation that is spreading to more people. Not just in baptisms, but in the way in which those people are. And yeah, there's more hardships as sins come in and people are forgiven. People are cleansed and the sins are given away and grace is able to come into their life and fill their life, and there is more given there. The riches were shared. What they had was shared, and generosity becomes the way in which they dealt with that. When we begin to look at all those things, we understand what it is that God was doing. He wasn't just promising, well, then you will have more for yourself. He was saying you will be part of the more that God is building in this earth. And what you have is going to be so huge and so big that it's beyond your comprehension. When Abraham looked at the stars of the heaven and God promised him that that's going to be your descendants, think, how am I ever going to afford Christmas? Well, that's just too many kids to even try to name. Or did he think, that's going to be family? And when Peter looked at Pentecost, and he looked at the blessing of Abraham that was being carried out on that day, it isn't all the people that we know. It's the fact that you're part of something that is so much bigger. And there's so many people that you know, and there is so much blessing that you know, and there's so much generosity that exists, and there are so many things that are full of forgiveness and love and grace and faith as we enter into a relationship like this. And it's what God tries to tell us about all of this, is this is the increase, this is the more, this is what we would want as far as abundant life, more so than, okay, your dog had puppies, and all your kids are going to have kids. More grandkids is always a good thing, right? You know, it is. But, you know, there ought to be a limit somewhere. You know, when you start thinking about this, it's really what God gives. It's really incredible. I saw this. It says, when we pray, God hears more than we say. He answers more than we ask. He gives more than we imagine. But in his own time and in his own way. And it's not always that we are the ones who are able to say, well, I got this from God as wealth. What we want is increase in love and grace and relationships, not just an increase in stuff. Not just in justice so that life is fair, but in blessing so that we get more than what God ever intended. It's the good stuff that God does. It's the increase in all the good things of God. We think new physical things will cure loneliness, and it doesn't. And so God gives us more relationship, more people. Sometimes physical things make more loneliness. He says, let me give you something that you want, something that you need, something that's going to fill your life. And as you look at letters of Paul, he talks about being filled. Filled up to the fullness of Christ, filled with the grace of God. And all of those ideas are talking about this better life, this abundant life. It's filled, it's overflowing. Paul's phrase is, we have nothing, yet we possess all things. What does that mean? That's what God gives. It's being in that image of Christ and realizing how big a part we have in all of the things around us that God has given. I hope you feel that this morning. If not, it begins with your salvation. That's where it all begins. It starts there. Peter started with that on Pentecost. Jesus started with that in his disciples. As he said, I want you to leave behind what you have and follow me. So it was a constant way of bringing them to him. Maybe you need to do that today. To find the more. It's not about getting what's yours. It's about trading it for what's God's. Shall we stand and sing?